Play from him was phenomenal. We have to assume that he knows the ins and outs of this mid lane matchup, and the pressure is now on. But as we get ready for the game, this is an opportunity for everyone watching. Head on over to Twitter, at LOO Esports, hashtag VITWin, if you think Vitality can pull it up, if you believe in NukeDuck. And on the opposite side, if you think Misfits can keep the ball rolling, can take this to 5-1, hashtag MSFWin. So we get ready to load up into game one.
Should be exciting. Obviously, even with the tanks top, we're still going to get a lot of action.
Fascinating.
Whenever sure. You have like aggressive junglers, aggressive mid laners, stuff will happen, for sure.
That's what I'm all about. The crowd's ready, the teams are ready. It's game one, ladies and gentlemen. Deficio's calling.
I'm not ready, I'm
out of
here.
He says action. Well, if there's that much action, I don't even need you. I'll just scream about the fighting.
Is that the play-by-play dream?
No.
No?
We need breaks, believe it or not. Oh. We can't talk continuously
for hours. I thought you could
hours.
Just keep yelling and yelling and yelling.
I mean, don't get me wrong. I'm a big old narcissist and I love the sound of my own voice, but I don't want to talk for an entire game.
That is fair then. Well, then I will talk about Hansama and his lovely boots. 4 potions now when you start this way. Obviously fantastic against lanes with a lot of poke early. And very, 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 very annoying to play against. Because you'll feel like, man, I just want that trade against this guy. Yeah, I'm really good. Oh, yes, 4 potions. Okay, well, I guess he's just going to go back to full HP again and again and again. And you sit with your one silly biscuit. It's just not a fair trade.
No, but the other thing, too, is how much has he given up in terms of damage stats? How many trades can he realistically take even with the one pot difference? I understand, right? We know Ezreal has to go back and get that tier. We know Ezreal's going to put himself in that gold deficit and Jhin will be comfortable. But Ezreal's not in that gold deficit right now. We already said that the lane is strong.
I mean, again, Nami Ezreal, especially at Worlds, was like one of the most dominating early game lanes you could get for the bot lane. Because, like, again, the first few levels is fantastic for these two. But then once you get to like 5 and 6 and 7 and so on, it kind of loses a little bit of the power. Nautilus is a fairly strong laner as a melee support, but he obviously has to respect the fact he's against Nami right now. And we might just see Ignar and Hansama try and get past the first few levels and then potentially look for some setups with ganks, because you can gank an army with double CC in your bot lane and Elise in jungle very easily.
Very easy to find the setup, but we're going to see where the jungle attention will go. Blue buff
into
the Gromp.
Yes, this is the sucky part when you play against double range.
Going to get zoned out. Kind of giving up the wave pressure right off the bat. Steelback also taking his time, freezing out the waves.
And this is a comfort pick for AOD. Like, the last time he actually did play professionally or semi-professionally was all the way back in 2014 on H2K. The lineup that had Oda Amner, Yanen, Febivend, these kind of guys. And he used to play a lot of Morgana, he used to play a lot of Nami. So obviously it's pure comfort, but as Vedia said in the intro, he's been gone for 2 years. He had to finish his studies, university degree and everything, smart man.
Goes forward, Power of Evil taken. I suppose an almost even trade, but definitely not looking comfortable there. Misses a skill shot. Does have the wave pressure in his favor.
Is it time to panic already? Can this man play
Ryze?
I'm nervous.
We haven't seen it yet. But luckily, every once in a while when we need to defuse the tension, we can look back at the top side of the map and understand that no one can kill anyone.
Oh, courage on the Ryze and not Storm Raiders that I see a lot of right now coming in from Power of Evil. Courage obviously has been nerfed quite a bit. After we released it, and it was insanely overpowered, it got 2 nerfs in a row. But he's actually opted into it to get more shielding in this matchup to avoid a lot of the bursts coming in from NukeDuck. But again, it's most of the time in the laning phase, it's going to be that shield against one guy, and it's
yeah, which means
not
that you're
very impactful.
More damage coming in from the Thunderlord's proc on the opposite side, so it's going to mitigate some of the damage, but it doesn't feel like a net add here in the early laning phase.
Definitely not. I like Storm Raiders a lot on Ryze. Especially when you don't run Ghost, I think it's even better. Because that mobility is just so important for him. But he's obviously running Cleanse here against the Levant. This is a good setup.
Good follow-up. Lots of damage being traded back.
All right.
Trying to find the snare. Not going to get it.
I got hyped. It was fake. The setup wasn't that great. Well, the setup was fine, but they didn't actually do much with the trade. Top lane fight, Dragos!
I got Deficio.
I'm trying.
I'm glad you're excited.
I'm trying to get you
no
going,
one's
man.
Dying yet. No one's dying yet. Keep it together. I know you want a bloody game.
I'm the kind of color caster who only likes trades. I don't want to see people dying. I just want to see trading all the time.
What? Is that a thing? Are there other color casters?
I don't know
like
if that is a thing, but you know, people like different things. So maybe I'm the one guy who prefers that. Some people, you know, they prefer LPL macro, and other people just think it's pretty weird sometimes. I've had a lot of discussions with people about LPL macro. Luckily now everyone agrees it's in a weird, really low spot.
And I mean, no stranger to the LPL, it's Kakao. Trying to find an opportunity to counter jungle, isn't going to get it. And now maybe turning his attention to the mid lane, really waiting for Joko to find a way in, but he is now on the top side.
You know what? I like Alfari a lot. It is so rare this man actually forgets to like ward properly. Obviously with the blast cone there, it's pretty easy for him to just ward the side lane brush, but so many top laners in Europe, they forget it. They get early ganked, they fall behind, they end up costing the team a lot. No, this man, I know it's super simple, but like he plays it safe. He never actually like purely overextends.
And once again, I mean, you say it's simple and it's a little thing.
It is simple.
But like almost every game we've watched in the last few years starts with one little thing, whether it's missing a ward, whether it's getting a good trade, whether it's burning a TP because of a bad trade. It's those little things that matter in the long run. And for now, Alfari is safe, and that could have been a big moment for the Kha'Zix to snowball, to find a lead for Vitality.
Very true. And it's going to be fun with these compositions. I just talk about like what we're going to see in the mid game, because both of them actually want to play on all three lanes at the same time. Like LeBlanc wants to go side lane, so does Ryze. So they're going to keep like facing each other 1v1 for basically the entire game. And then the two tanks up in the top lane. So split push on both sides. Team fighting is obviously always an option. But none of the comps are where you would look at it and say that's a pure team fighting composition, because it's not control mages in the mid lane. It's these skirmish mages with a lot of damage, especially single target. And that's going to be fun to see if one of them can get the advantage, because when you play 1-3-1 against 1-3-1, if your split pusher falls behind, you just lose that lane and you suddenly can't really set up the split push and you're forced into team fighting, which can sometimes be very difficult to execute.
I mean, so how much of this game is decided by these first early plays, by the first couple kills or towers? How much difference is a small goal lead going to make for two teams that, as you said, need to find a lead or need to find an advantage?
Small goal leads will make a huge difference. Two kills on either Blank or Ryze will make a huge difference and can suddenly snowball the game out of control completely. You still have to execute the split push, which is sometimes difficult to do, but it's what we often see with like mirror matches. And I think if I had to pick a comp in team fights, I think the Misfits one has a lot of good options with two tanks in the front line, a lot of flexibility from the jungler, and I also like the pick potential they have with Ryze Snare into Jhin W, into Hook from a Nautilus. Like, there's a lot of combo potential locking down one guy just when the fight starts.
Interesting, you see the pings coming out furiously as the jungle was warded there, as Joko almost gets taken down. Not going to be a first kill for anyone, so not going to be the start of that snowball that we're concerned about. However, team's now approaching level 6. It's not the mid-game quite yet, but we could see a little bit more explosive play. The kick is up and available. Ignar approaching level 6 on the depth charge as well. And this is where things get hard for the Nami.
Yeah. I mean, what do? You are a support with zero tankiness, no extra mobility other than a little speed up on yourself that actually makes you stop to cast W on yourself. Against Nautilus, Jhin, Lee Sin, like, I think Misfits have such a key way here to set up a gank in the bottom lane and try and get that bot lane tower and start that snowball. Kakao has level 6 now. We're waiting for Ignar to hit his level 6. Top lane is not really where you're going to focus your attention.
This is really smart. They saw Kha'Zix back out. They warded the jungle. They stole the red buff. Alfari goes down to take the Scryer's Bloom to spot out the Kha'Zix to confirm they're comfortable there. I got to say, this is... all of Misfits look like they're playing towards one goal right now.
And because Kakao is focusing on the bottom side, it allows Ansama and Ignar to push out their lane because they know they're not going to get ganked. As you said, they saw Joko on top side. So not only do they get a nice push on the bottom side, they get an Infernal Drake as a reward uncontested because there's nothing Vitality got on the map. And you normally always, with big objectives like Infernal Drakes or Towers, you almost always see cross-map trades. This one was just a free Infernal Drake for Misfits.
Joko walks into the red buff pit, realizes that it's gone, and now he goes, okay, so there might be vision here. But I don't even think he understands the extent of how much vision has been placed and how focused Misfits have been in shutting him down. One mistake on trying to take Krugs leads to all of this. And this is, I mean, it's not a massive advantage, right? But Infernal Drake's going to matter when it comes to two teams that want to split push.
Drake, as you said yourself earlier, it's the small things. And when you keep getting small advantages, vision, early Infernal Drake, a bit extra farm, a bit extra experience, it just starts slowly building up. And suddenly it becomes a big advantage. And suddenly you have like a 2k gold lead plus two dragons to zero. And you are really far ahead without having made any insane plays. Like, there's been no flashy plays here. We're 9 minutes into the game. This has been the most flashy thing. Maokai and Poppy trading. And yet, Misfits are able to get this small advantage.
Yeah, but when we look at it, you can see the CS differential between the two at this moment, and more specifically, how consistently Alfari has been able to find leads here.
The one that's important to look at is the middle one, opponent CS. This means whenever top laners play against Alfari, they get less CS at 10 minutes than the average top laner in the league. Because Alfari's been very good at not only denying CS, but then also understanding, you know, when to roam, when to leave the lane. So he's very active on the map despite sitting on a tank. And Kappershard last year was the guy who denied CS from the enemy, who got huge advantages and put the other guy in the dumpster. Kappershard hasn't been able to do that this year.
And it's past 10 minutes now, so we'll let Cabo take the rest of that wave. And as he does, you can see 11 CS differential. Alfari is ahead of the mark, more than 10 CS a minute here. And once again, small advantages are going to lead to so much more. This is the addition of the Ninja Tabi, the Bombi Cinder, much more comfortable trading. And it's not going to matter when these two fight 1v1. But when Maokai comes in and he's got an item over the Poppy completed, that's everything in a team fight.
And there's another reason I really like the Misfits team fighting here is the fact that the main damage source against the Maokai is like Ezreal. And this is a Maokai who's just stacking early armor. Then there's a Kha'Zix, physical damage. Poppy, physical damage. LeBlanc, yes, she's the magic damage dealer on this lineup. But if she's focusing the Maokai, Vitality is most likely losing the fight already.
Oh, OD caught. That's not how you want to start your stage performance. Flash and exhaust burn.
And we talked about this focus on the bottom side for Misfits against the Nami. It's working. They got Infernal Drake. They got a Flash and Exhaust that now makes it even easier to make that play. This bot lane tier 1 tower should be the goal for Misfits. And they're still down here using the Blast Cone.
Joko, they have vision. Kick lands. Going to go forward. Joko in trouble. Curtain call comes out. Hook's going to land. He's locked up. Shot. I don't know if that's a predict. But a good shot coming in from Hansama. Now low health bars, but nothing for Misfits quite yet. Nuke Duck is on the way.
Yeah, but PowerVival, he followed him down. PowerVival actually went back to his mid lane, so now Misfits has to be a little bit careful because Nuke Duck is still here.
Pulling back in the end, no one wants to fight any further, but pressure still in the favor of Misfits, still waiting hidden there in the brush.
And it's such a problem for Vitality now with this Nami Ezreal lane. They can't really pressure properly. It's obviously Tia Ezreal, Nami's early levels, they're long gone now. She's level 6, so is the Nautilus. This gives Misfits just full control in the lane and in the jungle.
Nuke Duck force back mid, but now power is bottom. Ignar not going to find the hook, burns the flash to try to get it, but the tower is set to fall, and there is no pressure here on the side of Vitality.
Nuke Duck is on his way down. He won't be here in time to stop the tower from dying. Might look for a fight.
Debating, walking back and forth, not sure what the next course of action is. Vitality hesitate. Vitality are caught out, and that means Misfits find a gold lead. 20.1k to 17.8 very early on in the game.
And this is exactly what we talked about, like that focused on the bottom side against the Nami lane, because you have so much CC, so much pick potential. If you get caught by one CC against Misfits right now, you're gonna get chained down. Like, it's again, there's Jin W, there's Nautilus Hooks, there's Snare from Maokai, Snare from the Rise.
Every single member of this team has some form of hard CC.
Yeah, I mean, the kickback from Lee Sin.
And keep in mind, we've been seeing a lot of comps like Corki, Varus, Rumble on the top side. I mean, very limited comps when it comes to CC overall. And this is, I think maybe Vitality aren't used to this, but you cannot afford to make a single mistake here against this team, because one just leads into another and you just get burned down.
I think the problem for Vitality is because of all the roster changes, it's been very hard to kind of lock down proper synergy and obviously proper strategies when it comes to early to mid game. And they're playing against a Misfits team right now who's just like doing everything by the book. They're not taking any chances, they're not gambling anything. You saw them back away as soon as Nuke Duck was roaming down. They knew exactly what to do to get the tower. So because Misfits is just making all the correct moves, all the safe plays, there is really no counterplay for Vitality at the moment. At least not an easy one. They have to like fight their way out.
Oh, and that's always hard to do. Joko's gonna get the blue buff, uses the ult to make it to safety. Well, the next move for Misfits, taking it by the playbook, is to shift their bottom lane to the top side. Now trying to burn down more towers, trying to find more advantages.
And you just need to keep PowerVival against the LeBlanc in the bottom lane. None of them have teleport, they can't just instantly leave the lane. And if they both roam, there's going to be an ulti from Ryze that's going to give him a head start as well in getting into that potential fight. So Misfits are able to push in multiple lanes at the moment, invade the enemy jungle, ward it, steal away camps. Again, small advantages, small victories. Key concept for a lot of professional teams. When you listen to like them communicating and talking. And it's so much about like track the jungler, track his camps. Then when can we walk in? When can we push out our lane and get deep vision? When can we steal a camp? And every time they do, it's like, yeah, small victory. We just got a small CS advantage, small experience advantage. And it's like, it always snowballs at some point, as long as you don't make that big mistake where you just randomly die in the mid lane.
And it's interesting,
or bot lane, whatever.
I mean, maybe a more experienced Vitality could have traded back and forth, right? You take an advantage, we take an advantage. But right now, this is just being given away. Vitality are caught consistently one step behind here, and it's just so brutal.
It is. I don't actually think with Vitality's comp, once we got past the early levels, I don't really see a way they could have really like punished Misfits in this laning phase. Maybe you can argue Joko focusing top lane and trying to trade, sacrificing bottom side to try and get Maokai down and see if they can get a top tower. But that's really hard to do and very risky. So it's really difficult for Vitality to force anything. Also because, again, Misfits have been able to track the jungler the entire game. They've been able to track Joko around, and he's a level behind now.
Not at all where you want to be. Once again, these entire team, both of these teams are about snowballing, finding leads, keeping their split pushers ahead. Nuke Duck goes forward. Nuke Duck may just go down. Power people, decent amount of damage. Nice disengage on the tidal wave.
We have to remember there's a small delay before LeBlanc can distortion back to her original place. That means it's very easy for Ryze to just snare her. And then again, follow-up CC, a follow-up damage from Misfits is very high. So it is extremely difficult for Nuke Duck to actually jump in with distortion and deal damage, and that reduces a lot of his impact in the game. He can't fully finish like any member of a full combo due to the risk of him getting CC'd and chained.
This is Misfits finding another tower. Not a single drop of blood has been shed. No one has gone down on either team. And while all this is happening, Kabo's catching a wave on the top side. He can't do anything to help his lineup out. And this is slow, this is steady play.
I love it.
And I mean, we expected a bloodbath, but this is surgical coming in from the side of Misfits.
I mean, I think it's just, yeah, it's really beautiful League of Legends. If you can win the game without having to make any risky plays, then you're almost playing a perfect macro game. It's too early to call it perfect. We're only 16 minutes in, but it's been a great start so far.
One man who hasn't had the best start to his season is Steelback, and while he was what we feel to be a very big carry force on Rockhat, even on what we considered a weaker lineup, Steelback's kind of dropped when it comes to performance overall. Yes, he's not died very much at all. The least deaths for 80 carries, but the damage just hasn't been there for him either.
Yeah, it's really strange when you look at his numbers. Again, yeah, you say he never dies, but his team is losing very often, so is that really a good thing? Doesn't just mean that he's sitting too far back in fights and he cares too much about staying alive. And I think it does sometimes. You saw the other numbers. Damage percent is the lowest of any AD carry. That is his damage, you know, on this team, who's dealing the most damage. His is extremely low. Damage per minute, that's just between him and all AD carries in the league, last as well. And it's hard to just blame him because he's now played with Hachani, Nuke Duck, and AOD as three different supports. And his team has not really functioned properly, and it's hard as an AD carry then to kind of get in there and have an impact. But there has been moments where Steelback could shine in fights, and he played the safe style, the old Fnatic Steelback style, where he was just going to be a cleanup. That doesn't work when you need to be the main carry on your team, and they need him to be their main carry. So I think he needs to start taking some risks.
Well, it hasn't happened yet, and the Ezreal pick is the definition of safety. Pulls back. Power makes it out. His itemization here, the Iceborne Gauntlet, another safe choice coming in for Steelback. Now, I'm not going to say it's the wrong choice. There's plenty of people to deal damage on this team. Maybe he wants to set them up, but between that, the QSS rushes, I just have to wonder if Steelback doesn't feel confident on this team, on this lineup.
No, again, it's really hard for him to feel confident that his team is setting him up to carry. I think the Iceborne Gauntlet here is not the correct choice. I think you need more damage to win some of these fights against the tanks. The Trinity Force build into a third item, Blade of the Rune King, is good against tanks. And I think an option for him to deal extreme amount of damage to the frontliner Misfits. The Iceborne one, yes, you're against Lee Sin, who's gonna try and dive towards you in the back line. But that's basically it. Like, I don't feel like it's necessary.
Nuke Duck goes forward, goes right back out. Nice block from the Sentinel, the Golem rather. Joko's caught on the side. Vitality are split and hesitating on the engage here. Joko leaps forward, wants to go in. Realm Warp comes out. Misfits not looking to pick a fight, looking to keep it clean.
They're going to play this game where they just don't want to take any chances. potential fight. Nope, out of here. Don't wanna risk it. Maokai back to the bottom lane. There's TP advantage now for Misfit, so this was another win. Another one of these small victories that's gonna snowball into more, because Alfari has a teleport, Kabushat does not, so Alfari stays bot lane. Whoever goes down to stop him from pushing can't join a potential fight in the mid lane or the top lane.
All right, so you're so excited now, Deficio. Where was the Deficio at like 1 minute where you're like, ah, they're gonna kill each other? Where's that Deficio? That's what I wanna see.
Well,
man.
That Deficio realized that Misfits are here to play the macro game. Misfits are not here to do what certain other European teams do and just fight, fight, fight. They're trying to do what G2 is doing. They're trying to play that clean style. And it's working extremely well. Like, this team is definitely one of the best in Europe at the moment. And they're here, you know, for the first time. This is the first split for Misfits.
And you got to think a lot of rookies on the team overall. We look at Alfari, Hansama, tons of experience in challenging, but their first time on the LCS stage. Power of Evil, no stranger here. Ignar, a little bit of time, but also relatively a rookie compared to a lot of veteran names,
definitely.
Especially with Power of Evil, Kakao. But this roster working out so incredibly well, 4-1 overall, and 20 minutes into the game, they already have a 5K gold lead. They have given up nothing for it in exchange. Three towers in their favor, zero kills on either side, two dragons backing them up. This is just...
It is. And as we talked about, 1-3-1 against 1-3-1, when one team gets the advantage, the other team suddenly looks like they can't do anything. Nukedog is trying to push out his side lanes, but whenever he gets to the river, he stops and he backs away because he knows there's no pressure on the map, so he can never push forward. He has to just surrender the wave, like we see right now with this wave just crashing up to the river. He walks away. He's like, yeah, I'm not going to go further. Because then if Power of Evil's there, mid lane might roam on him. They might spot Power of Evil actually allowing them to step forward and try and create a pick. But you can see how much they're hesitating, because they cannot do anything on the map. And that's a third dragon at 21 minutes now for Misfits.
And I've been informed by the EU LCS stats team that this is the first game where there were no kills at 20 minutes. Even G2, even the top team in Europe, has killed someone in every one of their games, or died before 20 minutes.
Oh, someone might die!
In for a fight, Ignar caught out, Joker wants to go forward, Ignar in trouble, Kakao moves forward, but the tidal wave knocks him up, Power of Evil is on the backside, they're gonna have to be careful, out comes the curtain call, Joker trying to find a way to safety, it's AOD who's getting locked up, will he be the first kill to drop?
No one is dead! No one is gonna die! This game is gonna end 0-0.
Okay, this is good, I like, audience, I appreciate
yeah,
that you guys enjoy this. This
respect to the guy who gave me a banana as well, nice guy. Yeah, see, he's up there. And you know what, Drakus?
What's this year?
Misfits are going for the perfect game. Turrets, no dragons, no kills, nothing.
There's been a lot of close to perfect games, you know. Separated
We've
by one kill.
We've had perfect games, too.
We've had perfect games.
And now, so Mid-Tower's gonna die. Vitality's 1-3-1 comp. Can't do anything. They don't have a winning top lane. They don't have a winning mid lane. They don't have a winning bot lane at the moment.
That's a lot of don'ts. What do Vitality have?
What they do have is the option to win game two.
Oh, wow. All right, are we that far down?
Hey.
Oh, my wow. People, you guys are a little harsh, all right?
They know it. Oh. There's still always the chance that, you know, you get that one pick that leads into, like, a potential Baron, but... With the way Misfits has been playing so far, it would be kind of weird if they suddenly start playing super aggressive and get caught out.
Yeah, and I mean, when we looked at the team, we were skeptical of some of their week one, their week two Baron setups. But by week three and week four, they were much cleaner.
Oh,
they had adapted, and AOD, this man is in trouble.
He's in the river. He's okay.
Ooh, Scuttlecraft's speed buff disappears. And Hansama does see the Kha'Zix. They're not going to get caught out.
So the goal now, Drakus, is Baron setup. And this is again where Misfits have been very good lately. We want to continue checking if it's perfect. They get to push top, they get to push mid, they get to push bot. So the river is theirs. No one else is going to go in there unless, you know, they want to fight you. Nukeduck, two items. He
so
has damage. Steelback, two items. Sadly, one of them is Iceborne right now. So his overall DPS
really
against the tank is basically none right now, which is a huge issue for Vitality. It's all on Nukeduck, honestly. To try and just create that one pick.
If they stall, the later the game goes, the less the gold
means. There's always a boring narrative. It's like, yeah, but if they get six items.
I'm just saying, Steelback gets that Blade of the Rune King, he starts hurting the tanks.
Okay.
It's a Lord
okay.
Dominix, he starts hurting the tanks.
Okay.
Maybe Maybe we see Steelback come back. Maybe we see the front line not afraid to kill anybody, Steelback. And they just pop off in a team fight.
Potentially. I do like this vision setup right now for Misfits. Four control wards around the Baron, even one behind as well to spot up. This is Warded though, guys. You are spotted, and now they realize.
No.
But they have full river control. They need to go back and push out mid again, though. Never forget to push mid, Drakus. I wish people were cheering for that instead of other things. Like, just cheer for mid lane pushes.
I mean, they're cheering for, like, death. Not player death, but, like, I mean, like, it's like,
yeah, yeah.
Like, it's like 50-50 for me as a play-by-play caster.
Mid lane push is, like, one of the most important things in League of Legends, and no one ever cheers for mid lane push. What about now?
Like, can we get a round of applause for mid lane push? Mid lane push!
Yeah,
yes!
Push it on Saba. There we go, he pushed it!
Woo! Look at him push the buttons. Look at those creeps, they're so helpless.
And now, he can walk into Baron. It's great.
All right.
But he's going to do another push. Wait.
To keep in the line of stats team fun facts, it's now 2017, but in 2016, all First Bloods happened earlier than this game. This is the latest First Blood, if there ever is one, in over a year and a half, DeFicio.
A year and a half. Well, Joko's trying. Oh, he might die!
Curtain call. First Blood, when is it going to happen? Time's going quick. Ryze is well morphing in. Flash forward, Ignar hits a minion.
He didn't
Backing
die.
Off. Chain connects. Not a whole ton of follow-up. Ignar actually might be in trouble here.
It's like they all forget how to play when it's about killing
steal
people.
Back.
Steelback!
Aggressive Steelback!
He's hiding!
First
no,
blood!
Hit
26
him.
Minutes!
Oh, he didn't hit
yeah.
him. He was right there! Yeah.
If he just had a Trinity Force!
No one wants to kill anyone in this game.
Well,
Ignar actually flashed in and hooked a minion, like, from the side. It was like, no, I don't want to kill him.
Mid lane push!
Yeah, mid lane push! Ah, there we go.
I understand, audience. My lust for blood grows greater every minute. We have to cheer for the scuttle grab. Deaths 2.
I mean, this is the hardest game for a play-by-play caster, because you're just building up and building up and building up.
I found alternative things to shout out, and I'm enjoying myself.
That's good, then. That's good. But I'm waiting for that one kill where you just scream like you never screamed before. No matter how the kill happens, you know, you're just going to go nuts. All right, let's get that Baron. We're 27 minutes in. Would also mean Vitality have to come and stop it, and then we're gonna get the fight.
Ward goes down, crowd goes wild.
It's gonna happen, don't worry. All right, push up top, push mid, start Baron.
Got it.
And then when Vitality shows up, stop the Baron and turn around and fight them.
Oh.
Uh-huh. He
wants
sees
a sweep.
Them.
Mid lane, not pushed yet.
Oh, look at
the
creep.
Cannon minions are important.
Oh,
is it over?
Bouncing grenade.
Nice. Dancing grenade. Dancing.
Bouncing. Why is it dancing when it's clearly bouncing?
Because it doesn't really follow like a pattern, like something when it bounces. Like Zig's bomb bounces forward.
Okay.
Grenades don't really like bounce that. I mean, I don't know. Man, I don't know. I'm trying to find a reason.
I feel like a grenade can bounce, but that's.
It
that's
dances.
Just me. They might start the Baron, guys. That means Vitality will come stop them. That means we might get a fight. Vitality,
8K,
move!
7K.
Your
butts. They know they're on the way. They're back!
They just backed down to... Man, the coach is sitting backstage and he's so proud. He's like, yes! We do not throw at Baron. It's fantastic.
AOT.
Everyone else.
Kakao.
Killens.
Curtain call. One shot. Two. Oh,
yes!
First blood! 28 minutes in. We get it. We did it, ladies and gentlemen. We made it. First blood.
Whew. We can go next now. We got all we needed.
That's right.
Funny enough, the rest of Vitality did not want to save the support. Nope. It was time for first blood. They all agreed. And now it's Baron time. Do we get second blood?
Second blood?
Notice how
we've been
Misfits...
28 minutes it took for the first kill. Is it going to take another 28 minutes? Oh, Cabo's in trouble. Kick goes in. Cabo knocks him out of the fight. Now moves back forward. Cabo's going to fall. Could be the second one. Power Evil gets another one. That's a start. Nuke Duck now pulling backwards. He has to be safe. Misfits pulling away, turning their sights back onto the Baron.
Well, we have Joko behind the Baron. He is spotted, though, so they're going to try and prevent him from stealing. Notice how Misfits are not killing the wards. That's really smart, because then it gives zero information on the Baron. They're just keeping them there disabled.
Oh,
Nuke Duck.
In trouble. Moving forward, Alfari gets the engage, but he's not going to get the follow-up. Now moving back, AOD may get caught out again. Is that going to be another kill for Kakao? He's killed AOD once. He kills him again. Alfari waiting on the Twisted Advance. Pulls back. Misfits, once again, just taking their time. They
what
like trying to do the bait.
A bloodbath this game has turned into. 3 kills at 30 minutes.
That's 1 kill every 10 minutes.
That is actually insane. They're trying again. I told you guys,
6K,
around Baron,
6K,
we're going to get the kills.
Joko, oh, he's going to get locked down. That is a guarantee, but flashes back to safety.
Oh,
and now he's delivered.
Surprise!
That's not where you want to be. Moves back. Is safe for now. Kakao, curtain call. Who's it going to be? Curtains for? Steal back running. Full ton of mana. Third shot connects. Fourth shot goes in. Alfari wants one for himself. He's going to get one.
And we're still looking at the perfect game. Misfits are just playing some really clean League of Legends where they don't give Vitality any chances. Jungler is dead now. No smite. Nuke Duck 50% HP. Steal back almost out of mana. And more
Apple
kills.
Running forward. Knocks back and then gets pulled forward. That was sick from Ignar. Oh, no denial on the Poppy. Ignar's hungry for blood, though. He's gonna flash.
Hey, the kill score's going up, you know?
This is good. I mean,
they started, Vitality walks in, Vitality dies, and then Misfit gets some more kills.
We got clean Macro, we got clean Baron, and people are dying. We're
Nuke
both
Duck.
Happy, but Nuke Duck's not gonna be happy if they get this Baron.
Well,
going
he's
lower.
Not gonna get it.
Yeah, gonna drop. Ezreal close, but no Cigar there.
Kind of feel like that has been Vitality in this game. That one random Ezreal ulti, just to try and steal, but you don't actually believe you're gonna steal it, but you're trying at least. You're trying. They're not even close.
That's a interesting metaphor.
I'm just saying, like, there's been no point in this game where Vitality were close to get an advantage.
No.
It's
sad to watch.
Just like, it's sad, but it's also fantastic to watch at the same time. Oh, that's a replay. Is this the first one where they kill him? So this is second blood.
This is the blood. First blood?
This
no,
is second blood.
All right, someone's already died.
Yeah, so they started, they disengaged. This is why they want to start the Baron in the first place to get the fight. Easy peasy, Kabuza dies. They go back in, they do the same. They try and kill Nuke Duck, but they get AOD.
And it's weird because no kills have dropped yet, right? This is second kill. They move forward, they take the Baron. And it feels almost like they might be even in team fights. And then you take a step back and you realize everything Misfits has gotten across the map. Everything they built for themselves. And they're just so ridiculously far ahead that there is nothing for Vitality to do.
Like, in terms of late game now, they're heading to
delivered back. Alfari's on the back line, so let's see the first death for Misfits. Are they going to take away the perfect game? Alfari, don't ruin it for your team. Taken down. Deficio, if there was just one less death on the side of Misfits, we would have a perfect game.
I know. It's not happening. Time to throw it all away. Daku on your screen, the head coach of Misfits.
Infuriated.
He's
so disappointed.
So angry. It's actually insane. We might see a new top laner next week from Misfits.
Yeah, it's just insane. Unacceptable. Honestly, the entire Misfits lineup is doing so well in this game. And you got to feel for Vitality. Vitality have the training shoes on. They're trying to put a team back together, and Misfits are 5 weeks ahead of them right now.
Vitality have the training wheels on the little bike, and then Misfits on the motorcycle just like run right past them instantly. Nothing they can do.
Well, it's 33 minutes. It's a 10K gold lead. It's 4 dragons. Baron buff still ticking down.
And you know what? Last time I casted Misfits, there were so many positives that I just couldn't stop kind of praising them. That it almost felt like, you know, it was just like, oh, everything to do is perfect. It is not all perfect, but in this game, it's been very close to.
I feel like when it comes to you casting Misfits, you're like that proud parent, right? Like, your kid's not perfect at soccer, but anytime he does anything, you're like, oh, look at him. Look at the way he kicks the ball.
I know.
So proud.
Look at the way he pushes that wave, you know, because he's a team player. And that's important.
He's smart. Just like his dad.
I have 10 kids here in the ULCS, and I'm proud of all 10 of them. But I do like some a bit more than others.
Who are the other 5?
Well, Vitality is also one of them. We're all one big happy family. But right now, we like Misfits a little bit more because they're improving a lot and they're showing some good games.
Vitality going down a dark road. You know, it's rough. They're resetting their life.
No,
they're just not.
They're teenagers. They got to find their own way. And it takes time.
Well, I'm going to try to reel it back as hard as it is for me. Once again, 10K, 11K gold lead. Baron buff finally going to go away. It's a brief respite coming in for the side of Vitality, but really, hope is pretty much dead for this game, and I think that this team has to be trying to figure out what's coming up in the next game. And for you, DeVicio, is there any one thing that they can change? Anything that can change to make this better?
I mean, it's hard, right? I like the Misfit draft, but it's not like I didn't feel like Vitality had any ways they could kind of win the game, but a lot of it just came down to like mid and bot lane for them. And as soon as they got like to level 5 and 6, Misfits just had full control basically everywhere. Really good with the Ryze counterpick against the LeBlanc. The fact that Power of Evil has not used his champion in over a year, and then he's practiced it, obviously in scrims and solo queue, everything, and he pulls it out when they leave LeBlanc open, which has been huge for Misfits to kind of control the mid lane. And then Kakao on this Lee Sin, again, he's just like, he's able to track the enemy jungler, he's able to have impact.
And I think when we go back to it, it really came down to Kakao and Ignar warding that bottom side of the jungle.
Yeah, great
and
setup.
A single misstep from Joko being spotted out on that ward led to just an explosive advantage coming out from the side of Misfits.
I mean, just as soon as they had those wards and they were controlling the bottom side, it was like, if you're Vitality right now, what do you do? Like, your playbook, and I said this yesterday about Unicorns in one of the games, like, you just run out of options. You go through the pages and there's just nothing. There's nothing on it. It doesn't say, like, camp top lane against the Maokai and try and trade turrets. Might be an option, but also extremely hard to do without losing your bot tower way earlier, and then Misfits just swapping to topside.
And the thing we praised Misfits for was having a great understanding of like the core macro concepts of League of Legends. Their team has been together a while, they know how to play together. Vitality isn't there yet, and it's hard to watch because these are players that we expect so much from, that we know have the potential to be this great team, but they have to relearn the basics as a five-man unit. Players that we've seen master the basics before, Kabo, Nukedust, Steelback coming in, now have to relearn entirely on this new squad. And it's such a sad state to see.
But it has been the current state in the EULCS where there is a pretty huge gap between top and bottom teams. Vitality obviously is sitting outside of playoffs right now. To make it even worse than Splice won yesterday against Fnatic, and Splice is just above Vitality in the standings here in Group B. Vitality has only won one series against Origin, so they're 1-4 at the moment. And it's just like, it's almost too late. It's not completely too late for them to obviously make playoffs, but the gap from them up to Splice, Unicorns, and H2K is pretty huge at the moment. And it would require Vitality to really quickly improve, like stick together with one lineup and just like learn everything within 2 weeks. Like the IEM week is where they're just gonna have to go ham.
And see, the thing is, we said the same thing for Splice and Fnatic, for teams that need to learn. But Splice and Fnatic had two matchups they were confident they could win. You know, the two teams below them in the standings.
Yeah.
Vitality only has one team below them. One matchup where they say, hey, we can just focus on our fundamentals this week. We can feel confident in coming into this matchup. But every other matchup is going to be a struggle. And that has to be so hard with a team that expected so much more. That morale has to be suffering. And I do not think it gets easier from here.
See if Joko is getting caught, because Misfits are around to fight.
Curtain call, two shots. Third going to connect onto AOD. Fourth goes wide. Team backing off in the end. Misfits just setting their sights on Baron once again. Force him back. Now it's time for the rinse and repeat. We saw it once before.
And if you want to have one critique with Misfits, something Vidius has talked about as well, like, they do tend to play very long games. Like, because they're trying to play so clean, they have some of these games where it just keeps dragging on and on and on, and they need that perfect setup before they actually do Baron or pull the trigger on a fight. And then the other team gets a lot of time to kind of sit there and get to 3, 4, 5 items. But you still have a great team fighting Kabo.
Yeah, that's a lot of damage. Kabo looks to find the disengage. No reconnect. Ignar might go down. No longer going to be the perfect game as it was earlier. Steelback finally gets a kill for himself, but AOD is caught out. He's set to fall. That's a little bit more going forward. Joko may get caught as well. Kakao is hungry for blood. Sonic Wave connects. No resonating strike to follow up. Misfits once again to find a quick pick.
Well, 1-for-1. AOD being the guy sacrificed again. Had a few deaths so far, but a hard game for him to play. First game on the big stage. Starting Baron.
Trigger. They have vision, they can see everyone coming in. Is there going to be a steal attempt? Steelback has no ult. We'll have it soon. Realmor comes forward. Looks like Power of Evil wants to start a fight. Has to pull back as TP moves forward. Kakao goes over the wall. They're not going to go for the Baron. Left all alone, Hansama gets popped. Steelback on the backside. That's a great start for Vitality. This could be big. Joko left all alone, leaps backward, wants to get the team to safety. He's still alive. No, flash forward. Kakao takes him down. It's too much. Kabo doing his best, but Nuke Duck just does not have enough damage. There are too many tanky members, but Steelback is here. He has the Blade of the Rune King. What can you do? He's slowly chipping down the life bars, but it just does not matter. Misfits are too far ahead. Kabo's going to try to stop the fight, but Misfits are going to keep it going. Hooked up, set to be knocked out. Tanky stats keep him healthy, but he's all but doomed to die. And Kakao taking his sweet time.
Just die? Oh, wait, never mind.
Well, once for it. AOD. All right.
Fancy moves.
Props to Kabo. Makes it out in the end.
But again, this is where, again, their one critique for Misfits, or like this, again, very, very slow late game. This Baron setup could have backfired, and Sama ended up dying. He tried to walk around and help his team. Starting Baron again, though, because they are this far ahead, this is your reward for getting four dragons. But 12,000 gold lead, whatever it is.
Han Sama isn't here. Kakao is not a major source of damage. They only have Power of Evil to dish out damage. They're not going to be able to steal it, though. Oh, goes down in the end. Ignar goes forward. He's got AOD locked up. They want to keep the ball rolling. Sonic Wave goes wide. Misfits get Baron. Once again, start to make moves onto the enemy base.
And this Baron should be what they need for the final push. I love seeing that, by the way.
That's a lot of CS. Ooh. That's a beautiful thing to watch. That's like the LeBlanc where you W the wave. And
you can see how hard this game has been for Nuke Duck to play. Let's talk about it after the replay. So everyone wants to kill Joko, so there's no chance he can actually steal the Baron. But it means Han Sama ends up actually getting caught out. He dies, and now it gets a little bit tricky for Misfits. Luckily for them, three very fit members are still here on full HP. And they kind of just take down each member. Don't know if there's anything else Steelback could have done in this coming in. Doesn't really have a whole lot of damage with this build. Didn't even get an auto attack down, actually. Just afraid of getting in a W range of the Maokai. And yeah, they all end up just running away. And it's like they're trying, but you just never believe it. You never believe this is the comeback.
I thought maybe for a moment. I saw Steelback on the backside, and then you watch that Q hit and do maybe 100 damage, maybe 200.
And then it actually helps the Maokai passive. So he gets healing quicker. And you're like, oh, I'm actually helping you right now.
Joko goes over, but it's way too early. Stealth up, leaps over. Kakao's pulled back to the team. Kakao may get dropped here. That could be a massive pick. 3k health. Joko can still move forward, still has smite. Will he have leap in time? Kabo gets cut down. Curtain call comes out. May just go wide, leap over the wall. He's not going to get it. Cut down midair. Han Sama, absolutely no mercy. Misfits advance forward, steal back. Insane amount of damage coming from the Elder Dragon.
That was one W. Ooh. With Infernal Drake, to
Death
be fair.
Deathfire touch.
Yeah, yeah.
Half healthed him. Ah, it's a grim fate to watch.
I love the Jin late game damage. Alfari's trying to stop the recall from Nuke Duck so the rest of the team can push. Seeing as Nuke Duck is technically the only member they're afraid of right now. We will find him. They're still chasing each other.
Steelback's going to try to make his way back between Baron buff and essentially five stacks of the Elder Dragon buff.
It's still going.
Where are you gonna go, Nuke Duck?
Oh, Nuke Duck, juke him.
Go? Run from the cat, Nuke Duck.
It's not a cat, though, is it?
He's dressed up like a cat. Don't assume his identity. Well, Tidal Wave goes in, tower goes down. Ladies and gentlemen, this is very likely to be
it. Nuke Duck is here. He made his way back.
Ah, Kabo can't knock anyone out. Knocks the tanks out. Nuke Duck has the exhaust dropped on him. Don't know how much he's going to get. Misfits just going to turn their attention to the base. They say, we'll keep it clean in the end. No need for more kills.
Slow and steady for Misfits. Hard to really critique a whole lot because they play fantastic early game, fantastic mid game. We didn't have first blood until, what, 29 minutes?
Yeah. 28 something.
28.
Crazy.
And yet Misfits had over 5k gold lead and three dragons at that time.
Have confirmed 28-23 for the first blood. And they were four kills and a single tower away from a perfect game. For sure.
And knowing they're the Misfits guys, you know, they're kind of just asking themselves, like, why didn't Vitality do anything? It was like, we literally just walked around the map, took bot tower, took mid tower, took top tower, took dragon.
I want to know how those games feel to play.
Oh, the whole
because I wonder, I want, no,
like,
I mean,
fantastic if you're winning.
Yeah, even if you're winning, are you like, yeah, we're slowly but surely getting them. It's going to happen. It's going to take 40 minutes, but we're going to do it.
It's a very slow, like, yeah, you know, you're just really building it up. You got like, good job, guys. Oh, no, Tao, great job. Oh, good job. And then when you finally get the first blood, we get excited, they get excited. The players are more like, oh, well, we already won the game, so great. We
I
got
mean,
first
they,
blood,
they won
know?
The game. Yeah, long before the 20.
When they got three outer turrets and two dragons, and Vitality was sitting near their own base defending with a comp that couldn't win late game team fights, Misfits knew that game was won already.
Yeah, interesting to see. But of course, we've talked enough about that game. For more on that one, we're going to head over to the analyst desk with Shox and Crew to break that one down.
Thank you very much, Dracos. There's no Shox here, I'm afraid. It is just me, because with such a clean game coming out from Misfits, we actually wanted to take a look at Kakao. We talked earlier on about him, but we wanted to have a look at how impactful his early game was and how it really solidified the lead that they were able to get. So you can see Kakao is going to start on the bottom half of his jungle, and notice that he is not only going to do it alone, but also on the top side, you're going to have Joko starting on his blue. Now for Kakao, this is massive because he knows that he's not going to put much focus on the top side, and he's aiming to get that early Infernal Dragon. So he does an entire clear, and the moment he's come back from the jungle, his priority is on vision. He knows that he's safe to do this because Joko's going to be clearing his top side jungle. That means that he can get all of this deep vision around the enemy bottom half to set up for the dragon later on into the game. Right, so we skip forward a little bit, and now we can see for Kakao, he's fully aware Joko is in the bottom half of his jungle. The only place he has to go next once he backs is the top half. So this is a prime opportunity for Misfits to make their way towards that dragon. So all of the Misfits members have now, they've gone back to base. Mid lane starts pushing in, bottom lane, they start pushing in. Kakao, he's stealing away the red buff because he knows he's safe to do so. And then Misfits immediately rotate round to the Drake. All of this setup coming from the early vision priority coming out from Kakao. And this just continues on because they then look to set up the bottom tower. And again, all of this deep vision coming out from Misfits enables them to get so much great control. And the great thing is, once they've taken away the bottom tower, they then just rinse and repeat. They move up top lane and they do exactly the same thing. A lot of this comes from their original draft, where a lot of what Vitality needed was a good early start. They had the LeBlanc, they had Ezreal and Nami. A lot of their early setup was winning lanes. And because they were not able to do this through a lack of early game pressure from Joko, Kakao could just have freedom all across the map and get himself great vision. Now, after that game, Misfits have the second highest first blood percentage. They have the second highest first dragon percentage. And they have the third highest first tower percentage throughout the entire league. This team has demonstrated why they are a top team in Europe. And I just wanted to highlight once again how fantastic their ability to control the early game to stem into a fantastic macro game, which enabled them a slow and clean win to the first game in this series. So right now we're going to take a quick break while the players prepare for game two. So don't touch that browser because we will be right back.
Over, Kakao's pulled back to the team. Kakao may get dropped here. That could be a massive pick. 3K health.